I'll open it up for questions. If you raise your hand, if you have a question, we'll get you a mic, and please wait for the mic.
All right. Thank you all for coming. Obviously, we wish we were still one of two teams playing today, but reflecting on the season, it was a successful one in a lot of different ways. And the biggest way was our last group meeting really was in right field and at the regional, and we talked about this group doing an awful lot of work to lay bricks of a foundation of something that everyone wants around here, and that's for Tennessee baseball to be a major player in college baseball. And I think this group deserves a lot of credit, and when that regional number goes up on the wall, it'll be something they can be very proud of. And it'll help with the memories that they had with this year's team. So keep it simple. You guys are usually good about asking the right questions. So ready for whatever you got.
Any questions? Okay,
Tony, how big was the contract extension and the raise? I mean, obviously that's really nice for you, but does that have a ripple effect in terms of, how the program's perceived by recruits and things like that?
It's incredibly crucial in a lot of different ways, and the number one way is recruiting. These kids are making decisions at an awful early age, and you see a lot of fluctuation in commits and what guys are doing with their decisions because of coaching changes. And having experience in recruiting, the whole thought process behind building this coaching staff was recruiting. And I felt like it was a staff that could stay together for a long time. Well, they've done an awful good job, and people know who they are, so people have tried to come in and get those guys. So it's kind of got a dual effect in a major way for us. It helped us keep those assistants together and our group together because it's what we all want. And also it assures recruits that not only is, you know, part of our staff going to be here in the very near future, this whole group is on board to do what we all came here to do. And, it benefits us greatly in both those ways.
To kind of build off that, you were on the road recruiting when that extension was announced. Was that something that got talked about pretty quickly when you were out there?
Yeah, it was kind of one of those things you already knew was going to happen. So they're, kind of like the regional. You never know you're in till you're in, but there wasn't the one moment for the coaching staff where we celebrated making it. There were several steps along the way, and that was a parallel to the contract deal. Coach Fulmer had initiated conversations about halfway through the season, and we felt like it was in our best interest, in Karma's best interest, to kind of hold off until the season was over. But I think both sides know that there's a high level of appreciation and respect there. I think there's a good chemistry right now between the whole athletic department, administration, and all coaches. And so we knew we were going to move forward. And it was something that could have got done right at the end of the season. But again, the number one priority from my standpoint became, how do we take care of the assistant coaches, and how do we make sure this whole staff stays together? And the administration, headed by Coach Fulmer, did what we needed to do.
We heard your contract extension had some facility upgrades included in it. Do you know what the first priority is?
Yeah, the first priority is literally getting done right now. We've got some gentlemen painting in our batting cages. So I know that's not a luxurious upgrade or anything that's going to be on the front page of the paper. But, there's just a lot of things that we kind of want to have our hand in or kind of help initiate our brand that we're trying to put in place here at Tennessee Baseball. And a lot of those things have gotten done since we've gotten hired, but there's also been just as many that have been put off for a later date. And we finished some construction in the locker room, for instance, right before the season started to give our guys more space, but there's really no amenities in there. There's been no dressing up of the locker room or decorating, if you want to call it that. So those are things that need to get done. So when our players come back in August, they realize, okay, there's a new tradition going on here. It's not just about making one regional or making headway with extensions or anything like that. There literally has been a facelift around here. And I think it helps with the mindset, but it also helps take care of our best resource. We're recruiting like crazy right now because it's summer. But the bottom line is our number one recruits are the guys that are on our team, on our campus. And we want to take care of those guys as best as possible. So cleaning up the areas or improving the areas so that they have a first-class working environment is the number one priority. and then we'll get into some bigger structural things.
Tony, you just mentioned the recruiting piece of it. The draft success that you guys just had, how much easier does that make recruiting that now you can point to these high school kids and say, hey, it's not only about the on-field success, but we're starting to maybe build a pipeline to the big leagues here?
Yeah, no, I think they can see it. And I've kind of beat to death the topic of the first few guys picked for us are guys who weren't known to be able to hit for power, guys who weren't known to strike somebody out, and Andrew Schultz, who was a great story to tell all year long. These guys had talent, there's no question about it, and they definitely met the coaching staff in the middle with great work ethic, but I don't think they would have been in those positions without those assistant coaches that we were talking about earlier with the extension. So that's how all that stuff is kind of circular and tied together, whatever the right, you know, words are for that. But you know, I think now there's something to point to recruits rather than just saying, here's our vision. And again, the assistant coaches have done a great job of painting a picture that is very clear for recruits to see, but it was a vision. And now there's some concrete things there that are truly tangible for incoming players and also potential incoming players to see.
Tony, do you feel like you got enough guys coming back that you can build off of what you did this year? Or is there a concern of maybe taking a step back a little bit with everyone that you're losing?
You know, I have a tremendous amount of respect for junior college coaches. I don't know how they do it, because turnover in a two-year deal there, especially when you have the draft in our sport, it's tremendous. Well, at an SEC program, we're not that far off. We're a little more blessed with, you know, seniors and things like that. But with guys in our league constantly getting looked at and given opportunities to play pro ball, there's an awful lot of turnover. And, you know, last year was a difficult summer because we got slaughtered in the draft in a negative way. This year, we have almost the ideal setup that we want. We want to help develop kids so when they're juniors, we can support them in signing a pro contract. We can encourage them to go out. We can give them advice on how to succeed. And it's a great building block for the program, something fancy to put in the media guide and all that. At the same time, we'd like to hold on to our guys that are incoming junior college transfers or coming from high school, because they can be the next wave of those guys to improve their status, help get their degree underway, and really just enjoy the college experience that is kind of the natural part of a young adult sequence of their life. So that's kind of the cycle you'd like to build, and it's healthy turnover. So in a roundabout way, what I'm getting at is you want that healthy turnover, and when you have it, there's going to be young guys who are ready to step into roles and basically continue the theme of the program. And I think we have some of those young guys. Some of our toughest kids on our team were some of the younger guys. And some of them were ones that didn't play every day that you guys didn't get to see, but we got to see it in practice. And I think it'll be a pleasant surprise next year with some new names for you all to write about.
The signees that were drafted, are you confident they'll make it to campus next year?
You know, like the Jerry Maguire movie, our word is our bond. That's all you can kind of trust. And we try and be straight up with guys in the recruiting process. There's not really a lot of punches we pull. And so I think that helps lead to a mutual relationship of families being honest with us. And the families that have been drafted and have not signed have said, we're coming to school. And we've met with them and we've talked with them. We don't really, try and compete with the whole situation too much, because it's tough to tell a family that $100,000 is not a lot of money, or $500,000 is this or that. It's really a decision they need to make. But what we can put in front of them is there's a pretty good track record of this coaching staff helping guys either increase their value or just really become more prepared when they do enter that pro game, which, you know, there's no way around it. It's cutthroat. So I think those guys will all be on board. Some of the guys who were not drafted because they said no to really good money and kind of dug their heels in. So teams figured, you know, why waste a pick? And it should lead to success for us next year, having some of those guys on board. Whereas last year we had a lot of guys take the money they were offered, which, you know, for a lot of them was a great deal.
Now that it's to the summer ball stage, you've got guys across the country it looks like you and your staff have very specific plans and ideas for working with hitters, working with pitchers. Any concern, or do you keep tabs on what their coaches this summer are talking to your players about as they try and improve their respective games?
You know, the brain is a very important thing, you know, in this sport. And if you confuse it with too much information, you'll get locked up. And I think, you know, everyone that's played has experienced that a little bit. And also everyone's experienced that clarity when you're thinking about nothing, you know, when you're at the plate or however you term it, when your mental game's on. So you want to be careful about too much information. But at the same time, the great part about this game is you can almost every weekend see something you've never seen before. You can turn on the Red Sox game and see nine different stances and nine different approaches at the plate. So I think it's important for our guys to gather information from not just the coaches that are around, but their other teammates that play at Nebraska, Florida State, Oregon. And you kind of got a little gumbo there, you know, with each summer team. And the kids need to learn, you know, because information's power. And if they're constantly learning, now they can add a few things to their game and eventually kind of have a full Rolodex of different things that help them. But again, like everything, there's a delicate balance. You want to be careful about overload. And you certainly don't want to do anything that's entirely contradictory from what Coach Anderson's trying to do with the pitchers or Coach Kivett's doing with the infielders or Josh with the hitters. But I think our guys are really starting to develop a sense of loyalty to this place and our coaching staff. And that type of loyalty and unity is what gets you to Omaha.
Did you guys have much of an opportunity to recruit Kumar Rocker? And have you given Tracy Rocker a hard time at any point about his kicking at Vandy?
No, I'm glad you brought that up. Hopefully, I don't know how social media works with stuff like this, but this needs to spread because it'll save all the coaches a lot of time and effort on the road. Everywhere we go, people ask, you know, why is he not at Tennessee? Well, I mentioned earlier, kids, you know, are making decisions in eighth grade, freshman year, sophomore year of high school. So Kumar was locked into his decision before we got this job, and he was locked in well in advance before Tracy joined our football coaching staff. And of course, you know, when we all merged here together, we formed a good relationship with not just, you know, Tracy, but all of Coach Pruitt's coaching staff, and it came up, and there was never going to be any change there to begin with. And I think, you know, it's obviously going very well for him. And at the end of the day, that's what recruiting is about, is it's finding a good match. It's not who offers you the best deal or who's the fanciest school to tweet out or anything like that. It's, you know, find a place that's the best match for you. And that's what we're in the process of doing, is find guys that are the best match for us. We were left some really good pieces from Coach Serrano's staff, but we also kind of have a different approach that we're going with. And I think as we move forward, it's going to be a much cleaner recruiting process for us. And maybe we can find another Kumar Rocker down the road, but that guy's pretty unique. I don't know if that's possible. But long story short, not our fault, not Tracy's fault that he's not here. And kudos to him for doing what he's doing. He'll be pitching in a major league stadium soon, and hopefully everyone in the state of Tennessee can cheer for him.
With summer ball, are guys healthy and participating, and have you been made aware of maybe any transfers or attrition with the roster?
Yeah, you know, Fergie is a guy who's still on campus because we'd like him to get healthy. We'd also like him to gain some weight, which he's teased about every day, and he's retaliating by doing a good job with that. Garrett Crochet just had everything that he needed to have worked on yesterday, and now he's kind of full go and clean up there, if that makes sense. And he'll go try out for Team USA, which he's really fired up about, to wear the United States uniform. When it's actually the United States uniform, about everyone wears the colors now. It's got to be the greatest honor, I think. So those are the two things that stick out with injuries. You know, other guys have seen, okay, we held on to a lot of guys in the draft. There were several guys I could rattle off that were on our current roster that could have went out and played pro ball. And some of those guys may still make decisions like signing a free agent contract. They're out there trying to work things in summer ball. So the roster is not settled on the back end or the returning players. And then on the front end, the incoming guys, you know, we're locked and loaded. All those guys are going to come in here and show us what they can do. So any news that pops up will be new news to me. But at the same time, we won't know who our roster is till about July 15th, and that's the same for every other college baseball team across the country.
With Tennessee and Team USA, there's been a connection there. What does it mean to the program as well as Garrett Crochet to get that opportunity? And then also, what's it like to see there aren't many college graduates that get a chance to pitch in the Cape? Will Heflin making the most of his opportunity up there?
Yeah, he's killing it. And we really didn't know which way things would go with Will. And, you know, I was eating with Coach Anderson and a recruit down on Market Square and got a call from Will. And I was like, I don't know what's going to happen here. It was the last day of the draft. And he said, Coach, I want to come back. And I think that regional experience did a lot for a lot of guys. But I think he just had a blast. I mean, out there, he got to pitch, obviously, several innings. But I think being there, you recognize not only how great it is, but how disappointing it is what you were missing out on before. And I think he wants to experience that more. So a pretty cool deal from a kid who stated himself, the reason he came to Tennessee was to change things around or solidify the program. And that's what he had a heavy hand in and will continue to next year. So it's neat for him to be pitching at an elite place like the Cape Cod and getting to compete against some of his teammates up there. It means we're at a strong point in the program when there's that many guys up there. And then, you know, it speaks volumes to the program, too, that Team USA is willing to come get one of our guys. We obviously have nothing but great things to say about Garrett, but the Cape, Team USA, those are places that are very selective that have to come to you, and they're not going to come to you unless they think the guys are talented enough. But, you know, I think also are capable of going about their business the proper way. And so it's a huge compliment, and it's a great thumbs up for the program.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you all.